I'm Stephen Scheuer, welcoming you to another in our series of oral histories, in which we are fortunate indeed to be able to interview those persons who have helped shape the style and substance of television and our major media today.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
Was there any other experience that you've had that was so wrenching, and to this day it seems amazing you were able to keep your composure in that way?
Well, barely kept my composure. No other experience quite like that. Nothing, not having to announce but a young, popular president of the United States had been assassinated in such a fashion.
See, TV itself is a fantastic medium. And I hear about cable TV and access radio. That's interesting and hopeful. More and more channels are opening. At the same time, who's buying these channels? There we go again, you see. The big problem is, let's be specific now. General Electric owns NBC. Now, Brokaw is a good man, but suppose there was a scandal involving General Electric chipping the public, and Brokaw comes on and brings it. He's out on his Tegucigalpa tomorrow. Now, CBS is owned by Westinghouse, and Dan Rather, who's a good man, is there. He's saying, here's what Westinghouse did yesterday. Let me tell you about it. Boom! You know. ABC is owned by Disney. Well, now, Disneyland's a big scam, someone, Peter Jennings, about to say. I'll tell you about the scam it is, how the young are taken by it. Boom. So you see, we're more and more and more, and then need you talk about Fox and Murdoch. Well, that then you come close to obscenity in my book, you see. Murdoch has become almost a metaphor for it, you see.
Well, Murrow was a young man on the executive escalator whose voice cords were touched by angels.
And I request your permission to read from script whatever remarks Murrow and Friendly may make. If the senator feels that we have done violence to his words or pictures and desires, so to speak, to answer himself, an opportunity will be afforded him on this program.
He wrote well, he wrote beautifully, or dictated beautifully, often didn't write at all. And he told the story well. He really held your attention.
Our working thesis tonight is this quotation. If this fight against communism is made a fight between America's two great political parties, the American people know that one of these parties will be destroyed, and the Republic cannot endure very long as a one-party system.
The American people realize that this cannot be made a fight between America's two great political parties. If this fight against communism is made a fight between America's two great political parties, the American people know that one of those parties will be destroyed, and the Republic can't endure very long as a one-party system.
As a nation, we have come into our full inheritance at a tender age. We proclaim ourselves, as indeed we are, the defenders of freedom wherever it continues to exist in the world. But we cannot defend freedom abroad by deserting it at home. The actions of the junior senator from Wisconsin have caused alarm and dismay amongst our allies abroad and given considerable comfort to our enemies. And whose fault is that? Not really his. He didn't create this situation of fear. He merely exploited it, and rather successfully. Cassius was right. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves. Good night, and good luck.
And I think that being one of his lieutenants, being the one he chose to succeed him as chief European correspondent, was one of the great honors of life.